knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
We just learned about aspirin, so let's touch on another very popular drug, acetaminophen. Acetaminophen was first produced in 1877 by Harmon Northrop Morse at Johns Hopkins University. It wasn't tested clinically, however, until 1893, when it was compared against another leading analgesic of the time, phenacetin, by Joseph von Mehring. Mehring noted that phenacetin use could lead to methemoglobinemia, a condition that limits the transport of oxygen to cells in the body. Because of this, phenacetin was only used extensively until 1949, at which point biochemists David Lester and Leon Greenberg showed that not only does the body metabolize phenacetin into acetaminophen, but also that acetaminophen is just as effective as phenacetin, does not cause methemoglobinemia, and is not carcinogenic, whereas phenacetin is. Consequently, acetaminophen became widely used, and now it is one of the most used drugs in the U.S., commonly combined with other active ingredients in over 600 medicines. Acetaminophen, more commonly known by the brand name Tylenol, and also paracetamol as it's called outside of the U.S., is often classified with NSAIDs, or non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. Although it is prescribed as an antipyretic and analgesic, it is not a true NSAID because it has little to no anti-inflammatory activity. Acetaminophen can reduce fever and increase the threshold for painful stimuli. But unlike any NSAID, acetaminophen only very weakly inhibits the cyclooxygenase enzymes that produce prostaglandins which lead to pain, fever, and inflammation. Because of this, acetaminophen is not a suitable substitute for NSAIDs in chronic inflammatory conditions such as rheumatoid arthritis. The mechanism by which acetaminophen produces its effects are actually not well known. It has been suggested that it can inhibit cyclooxygenase enzymes more effectively in the brain and central nervous system, leading to its antipyretic and analgesic effects. These sites have a lower concentration of compounds called peroxides, which are produced at sites of inflammation and have been shown to affect how well acetaminophen can inhibit cyclooxygenase enzymes. Others have suggested that this drug could actually inhibit a third cyclooxygenase enzyme, COX-3. Although humans possess the gene that encodes this third COX enzyme, no studies have demonstrated its expression or function in humans. The weak inhibition of cyclooxygenase enzymes makes acetaminophen a good choice for pain and fever relief with little of the blood thinning or gastric effects that are common to other NSAIDs. Acetaminophen is therefore prescribed in children and certain adult populations, like asthmatics, who may have bad reactions to aspirin. Though acetaminophen use does not produce the common NSAID side effects, it can at high doses cause liver toxicity, which is an inflammation of the liver. Acetaminophen can be processed by the liver to be removed from the body by two pathways. Normally, acetaminophen is metabolized in a process called conjugation, where a drug or its metabolite are chemically coupled to an additional molecule to increase its solubility and ability to be removed from the body. Within the levels of a safe dose, molecules of sulfate or glucuronide are covalently bound to acetaminophen in order for it to be excreted. Too much acetaminophen, however, will overload or saturate this pathway, causing excess drug to be shunted to a pathway where it is metabolized via oxidation by the liver enzyme cytochrome 3A4, or CYP3A4. Metabolism of acetaminophen by CYP3A4 creates a toxic product called NAPQI, which must be conjugated to a molecule called glutathione in order to be excreted. High levels of acetaminophen overloading this pathway can deplete stores of glutathione, leaving the reactive NAPQI product to covalently bind to and disrupt other proteins in the liver, leading to potentially fatal liver dysfunction. This risk is more significant in people who are fasting or consuming alcohol. Malnutrition can lead to the depletion of glutathione stores, thus limiting the liver's ability to protect itself from the toxic NAPQI metabolite. And consuming alcohol can strain the liver as well as induce or increase the amount of CYP3A4 enzymes that generate NAPQI from acetaminophen. So with acetaminophen covered, let's move on to another of the best-known drugs in the world, ibuprofen.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.